Okay, so Michael, here's some pseudocode that represents an algorithm of the sort I just described after the last quiz. So here's the basic idea. Just see if you can picture this. We're in the middle of this process. We have some theta at some time, step t, and we're simply going to generate samples that are consistent with that distribution. So we're going to treat our probability distribution as not just something that gives us a probability, but something from which we can sample. So generate samples according to p sub theta sub t. Generate a bunch of those samples, and now that we have these samples, we're going to come up with a new theta, t plus 1, and that theta t plus 1 is going to be the best samples that we just generated. So let's say the top half. Now, you'll notice that this should actually remind you of something. Does it remind you of any of the other randomized algorithms that we've looked at so far?
Maybe a little bit like simulated annealing?
No.
Because it does, you know, change the probability of going up. Where we're choosing things for a percentile. That's a lot like genetic algorithms.
Right. It's exactly like genetic algorithms, except instead of having this population that moves from one bit to the other, we generate samples that's like our population. So we generate a population here. We pick the most fit of that population by retaining only those that are the best ones. And all the stuff that you said before about, well, maybe you don't want to pick the best ones. Maybe you want to sample it according to a probability distribution proportional to the fitness. All those things you talked about before would apply here. But let's just stick to the simple case where you take the best ones. And now that we've got this new population, rather than using that population again, we estimate a new distribution that's consistent with those. And then we just lather, rinse, repeat until we come to some convergence.
Okay, so let me just make sure I'm following. First of all, when you say pea soup, you don't mean the food.
I do not, because I do not like pea soup.
And you don't mean soup meaning like the largest possible value of theta, because when I was hearing pea soup theta, I kept thinking that you meant the best theta.
No, soup is short for superscript.
Just superscript.
Like right, people say pea sub I, which means subscript.
Oh, yeah. Okay, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And okay, so now that that's clear... This notion of estimating a probability distribution, I guess that's where it feels really fuzzy to me, because if you do the estimate as a kind of, I don't know, sort of particle filtery kind of thing where you just keep instances, then it feels really a lot like the genetic algorithm.
Right. Except remember, one of the things that we cared about was structure. So this structure that we're maintaining, remember this complaint that I had that we weren't somehow keeping track of structure in a nice way, is all going to be hidden inside how we represent these probability distributions. That is going to be the structure that moves from time step to time step rather than just the population of points moving from time step to time step. And I'll get into some details about that in the very next slide. I just want to make certain that you understand the high level bit here.
The high level bit. I'm not yet connecting it with theta in the sense of the previous slide.
Ah, so theta is our threshold, right? So basically we have some distribution. Now remember, what is P superscript theta? It is a probability distribution that is uniform over all points that have a fitness value that is greater than theta, greater than or equal to theta, right? So I have some distribution here. If I generate samples from that distribution, then what this means is I'm going to be generating all the points whose value, whose fitness is at least as good as theta. And then I'm going to take from those the set of points that are much higher than theta, hopefully, and use that to estimate a new distribution. And I'm just going to keep doing that. And what should happen is, since I'm constantly taking the best of those, is that theta over time will get higher and higher and higher, and I'll move from theta min over time to theta max. And when I get to theta max, I've converged and I'm done.
I see. So, all right, so the theta, right. So I guess I was confused because I didn't completely absorb the second line yet. So that we're updating the theta, and it's specifically going to be tracking the, I'm not sure what the nth percentile is. So is n the number of samples that we draw?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. If nth means, you know, 50th percentile or 25th percentile or 75th percentile.
So, okay, so if you set that to be the median, which is the 50th percentile, then what we're doing is we're sampling, we're taking the top half of what's left, we're somehow refitting a distribution to that set of individuals that were drawn, and repeating in the sense that now the fitness of those individuals, the median should be higher because we're sampling from kind of a more fit collection.
Right. That's exactly right.
Okay.
So this should work, or at least it should match your intuition that would work, if there are sort of two things that are true. The first is that we can actually do this estimate.
Yeah, that's the part that scares me.
Sure. Well, given a finite set of data, can we estimate a probability distribution? So that's the first thing that sort of had better be true. And the second thing that needs to be true, and this is, I think, a bit more subtle, is that a probability distribution for P sub theta and a probability distribution for, say, P sub theta plus epsilon, that is a slightly higher value of theta, should be kind of close. So and what does that mean? What that means is that generating samples from P sub theta of T should give me samples from P sub theta of T plus 1. So I have to, that means that not only do I have to be able to estimate the distribution, I have to do a good enough job of estimating this distribution such that when I generate samples from it, I will also generate samples from the next distribution that I'm looking for.
Okay.
Okay? So if those things are true, then I hope you can at least sort of imagine that you would be able to move from the part of the space that's at theta min and eventually get to the part of the space at theta max.
Yeah, it seems like it should climb right up. Yeah, I agree with that. Just assuming that you can represent these distributions in between. Again, the picture that I have in my head is like a bumpy mountainous landscape, and you put a slice through it. And in the beginning, yeah, right. So in the beginning, it's the whole space, and that should be easy to represent. At the end, it's a single point, and that's easy to represent. But in the middle, yeah, like that. But in the middle, it's this sort of crazy. There's a blob, then there's a space, then there's more blob. There's a little blob with a hole in it. So like that might be a much harder distribution to represent.
Right, and that's going to turn out to be an empirical question, but as I hope you'll see in a couple of slides, it tends to work out pretty well in practice.
Cool.
Okay, and by the way, when it doesn't work out well in practice, there's all these cute tricks that you can do to make it work out pretty well in practice, and we'll talk about that towards the end. Okay,